The problems of the world are complex. We're faced with climate change, with financial crisis, with conflict and war, to mention just a few of the unsolved problems. Neither companies nor politics has managed to solve them yet. And so our world is really in bad shape, it seems, at the moment. We see signs of destabilization everywhere. This creates existential threats. Our conventional recipes don't seem to work for this. We're addressing them with regulation. Thousands of laws are made every year, but that puts a lot of obstacles in the way, and many decision makers feel, you know, this is not going to be helpful for what we need to do, and it's costly too. So basically, most industrialized countries have so high public debt levels that we need to ask the question, can we afford to go on like this? It seems we need a step change. Well, we need a solution that works for the entire society. So how could the new solution look like? And in fact, I believe that many decision makers are thinking about this. And TTIP is probably one approach. So the question behind is, could corporate control solve our problems? And if you look at the map of multinational companies, for example, IT companies in the world, we see, well, the world is also fragmented here. So would it really work? Moreover, companies are pretty short-lived. 40% of today's top 500 companies will be gone in 10 years. Could we build society on this? There is an alternative model that's often discussed, which is called the China model. And the idea of a powerful government that can decide basically what needs to be done without too many obstacles. And so one can decide to build a street over here, and a shopping mall over there, and an entirely new city over there. And the question is, wouldn't that be great if we could do that too in Europe, in the United States, and elsewhere? But it seems that also this model has its limitations. And in fact, a lot of these shopping malls that were decided this way are just empty. They're ghost malls. They're entire ghost cities. And there are unsolved problems such as this one. Smog has made some cities almost unlivable. Well, one could say people make mistakes. And the question is, can we now turn society in a perfect clockwork? Can the data fix our problems? And in fact, there's a huge amount of data that's now becoming available. In just 60 seconds, we produce 700,000 Google queries, 500,000 Facebook posts. We create data about our locations, about our shopping behavior, and all our activities are leaving some digital traces. So the question is, can we soon know everything? Can we create even a crystal ball that can not only see what's going on everywhere in the world in real time, but maybe even predict the future? And in fact, there are some companies working on this. One of them is called Recorded Future, as it was already written up in the book, and you know, it would just be played back. And of course, the military is working on these systems too. So the question is, could we, with all this knowledge and all this technology, decide to act like a wise king? And how should we do this? Well, in principle, with TISA, it would probably be possible to have all the information flow to one place, and then the question is, could at least the Western world be centrally controlled? That's a theoretical question, and maybe even a practical one, and you should better think about it. If you wanted to do this, how could you? So certainly the digital revolution is on its way, and we'll have computers that overtake humans, just a matter of time. Some people think it will be taking 25 years, others think it will take 5 years. Maybe it has happened already. So, for sure, intelligent machines are now better chess players. They're better workers in many areas. They will probably be better drivers. And in many areas, they have better knowledge too. Robots now are not anymore programmed line by line. They can learn. They can build other robots. And they could build better robots. So robots could actually multiply and evolve in a sense. And so we'll see an accelerating pace of the evolution of artificial intelligence. And of course, companies and governments are very interested in this. For example, China wants to build a China brain. Baidu, the Chinese search engine, is engaged in this and was asking the military to join with substantial financial contributions. And we recently hear a lot of critical voices about artificial intelligence, like Elon Musk, the technology genius in Silicon Valley, says, "I think we should be very careful about artificial intelligence. If I had to guess and what our biggest existential threat is, it's probably that." 2 or 3 years ago, when I read about artificial intelligence as a possible threat to humanity, I thought it was absolutely ridiculous. But now there are more and more people who are alerted. Stephen Hawking says humans were limited by slow biological evolution, couldn't compete, would be superseded. And Bill Gates of Microsoft says, "I'm in the camp that is concerned about superintelligence." And finally, Steve Wozniak, one of the co-founders of Apple, says, "Computers are going to take over from humans, no question." But will we be like gods, or will we be treated like family pets, or will we be like ants that get stepped on? I don't know. So this is the question. Now, another question is, why are these people who know a lot about technology so nervous? How would super intelligent machines, if they could be built, used? I think it would be a cybernetic society. And actually, this has been tried to do already some time ago in Chile. When Chile was a communist country, they were building this cybernetic center and trying to control material flows of production of the country. And it's a very interesting story. I recommend you to read about it. And it's hard to say, was it a success or failure? But it ended very badly for that president. And we don't want future cybernetic system to end similarly tragic for our presidents and chancellors. So we need to think and talk about these things. And in fact, these cybernetic society ideas are not dead. They're still living on. And for example, Singapore considered itself as a social laboratory, and they're applying a lot of these ideas. And China is engaging in this too. So it's planning to rate every citizen's behavior, including everything they do on the internet. And then depending on your score, you would get certain jobs or not. And other things, like loans. So the question is that good or bad? Well, certainly knowledge is power. And the question is, could so much knowledge and power a benevolent dictator or wise king? And would it be really good for society? Well, one possibility that hasn't been available at Chile times is that we can now manipulate people's choices by personalized information. So the question is, will we be remotely taught, or is this already happening? And actually, this is not only happening already in personalized advertisements. Of course, this is also interesting for politics, and there it's called nudging or soft paternalism. And it's being used already. Now, how good or how dangerous is this? Given that actually now search engines can know what we're most likely to vote. And not only this, they could actually manipulate the result of an election. And they might even endanger democracy. So we need to talk about this. Because powerful tools enable serious misuse. Now, assume you have this all-powerful tool in the world, it's created now, and it was created for a wise king. But then, of course, terrorists, extremists, and also organized criminals would be very interested in getting access to this tool. And in fact, what needs to concern us is cybercrime is exploding. Now costing us $3 trillion each year. And basically every company, but also every institution has been hacked in the past, so there is no absolute security. How can we protect us from this? And besides this, I believe mistakes will always be made, no matter how smart a super intelligent may be. And if we apply a certain solution to though it could be disastrous. How can we control such a super intelligence? It's so fast, so intelligent, so powerful. Now, what would it do? Well, in any case, we can already see that the digital revolution undermines the basis of today's economy and societal institutions. So, perhaps the digital society is very efficient in future, but the question is, what will be our place? Is it enough to have food, water, and shelter? Or do we need to have a job, a meaningful job, a purpose of life? Well, certainly, jobs are lost already, and in some countries we have now unemployment rates of more than 50% for young people. Even in Japan, 50% of people don't have a permanent position. So we need to be worried about this. But let me say, I believe there is nothing wrong in general about big data, artificial intelligence, or cybernetics. It's just the way we use it that makes the difference. And my concern is that we might be actually on task A. So if we just continue going this path, that could cause an economic and societal revolution. So we need to learn a new kind of thinking about our society. And here is a new approach that is consistent with individual autonomy, with democracy, and jobs for everyone. Distributed data and control to enable self-organization. And so, my idea is that we don't need to keep all the data that are being produced in the world in one place. So for self-organization, and that's what I'm going to go into more details in my second talk, we just need to have real-time feedback, and then we can throw away the data that we have measured. And in fact, that's a scientific approach, as we applied also at CERN, which is the biggest civil big data infrastructure. They're throwing away 99.9% of their measurement data because we could never process them, but also they're just interested in finding out about a certain question. So they want to confirm or falsify certain scientific hypotheses. And these hypotheses have certain kind of implications. They're just measuring what confirms or contradicts. predictions. All the other data are thrown away, so it's a tailored measurement process now, and I think we should do that too. So, this is today's universal tool. It's called a smartphone, but actually, while most people have it in the civilized world, I think most people don't use it most of the time for making phone calls. The more interesting thing is that there are 15 sensors approximately in one smartphone. And so what we can do is we can actually connect all these smartphones and in this way build a measurement system. It could be a global measurement system, but the system I imagine would be pretty much decentralized, as I said before. And of course, the Internet of Things will create a lot of data in the future, but therefore, we need a system we can trust. Now, if all our steps, all our words are recorded and kept forever, we couldn't feel comfortable, I guess. We couldn't be creative because we would always be afraid that maybe it's an idea that other people don't like. But anyway, some ideas that other people don't like might be those ideas that we need to solve our problems in the future. Trust requires transparency. And so I think open source is a good idea in this connection. And what I'm suggesting is to build the system actually as a citizen web. That means you and us together, an open system like Linux or Wikipedia or OpenStreetMap, jointly created and jointly used. And it would be a system that's controlled by us, by every one of us. So basically, we'll have maximum control. You can decide whether you want to open up this center or that center, whether you want to use the data that's being measured for yourself, or whether you want to share this data with other people. And moreover, what we hope to have soon in the future is also something like a personal data store that would allow you to keep control also of data that has been created in the past. So all data about you would be in a data mailbox where it can be administered. So for example, if you decide that you want to share the shopping data with companies because you want to get personalized services or products, then it could open up these kinds of data for that purpose. If you want to share your friendship network just with your friends and family, you would also do this. And if you want to share your medical data just with your doctor, you can decide so too. If you don't want to share it all, okay, that's fine. Now, what can we do with this kind of data? Well, let's take this example of acceleration data in X, Y, and Z direction. There's just one smartphone that's shaking, and probably you're just doing a mountain bike ride, but if all our smartphones are shaking at the same time, that would be an earthquake and could warn our friends and family in real time, give them some extra seconds to get into a safe place. So, why don't we do this together? You know, we could create this dimension of this as a participatory system and create a data commons, an open real-time data source for everyone. So the success principle of this would be give and take. You could take data to create your own services, consultancies, products, whatever you want to do, your own science. And of course, for this to work well, you should give some data back. Same thing with source codes. You know. To create data, we need to have measurement protocols. And basically, those would be open source. You could download them, you could modify them. So assume we have created 20 different ways of doing measurements. But you have 9 own ideas what you want to do with this. Then you sit together with your friends or colleagues, you know, you download some of the code, modify it, you know, upload it back. So basically, Within a short time, there will be so many opportunities because everyone can take modified internet back, and this way we would have an exponential increase of opportunities. So the idea is to create new opportunities for everyone, which is of course very important given that about 50% of jobs, of traditional jobs, will be lost in the next 10 to 20 years. So we need to create new opportunities for new jobs. So I believe if such a system is set up well, enabling users, customers, and citizens will lead to better services, better products, better businesses, better neighborhoods, smarter citizens, smarter societies, and with a micropayment system on top, everyone can establish an own business and come up with own services and products and sell them all over the world. I personally think this is extremely exciting, and there are many young people who think so too. You know, it can be a lot of fun too. So we can turn sensor art into music, we can turn cities into adventures, we can play games, and actually this is not theory anymore. No, I have a team of young, dedicated people that is working on this planetary nervous system. We call it NervousNet. The web page is not ready, but there's an app too. You can download it from Google Play Store, and you can also download it from the iPhone, Apple Store, iTunes. And here's just one funny application actually. There will soon be more videos. And so basically what we're doing here is we're playing a competition game, right? Assume people can decide whether they want to go to this movie or that movie, or play this TV program or another, or go to this restaurant or another, whatever. So we're going to do a virtual arm wrestling over here. And so we have two teams basically, and we're measuring how hard people shake and which is the stronger team. So this is illustrating actually a number of issues over here. First of all, we're not interested in measuring what one person is doing. We're not trying to interfere with people's privacy. We are aggregating over several sensors. Second of all, this is playful. You can also change the sensors you're using. So for example, if you can change from the accelerometer towards the light sensor, then you can make a competition of who catches more light. Now there will be soon very nice movies about this game. Or you can make a competition, you know, who catches more noise. We could, in my second talk, I will show that basically you can use this in order to produce a noise map of cities and entire countries, in fact. Yeah? So this is not just about having fun, it's also about creating new scientific instruments. This fun part is mainly important. We need to make people sign up for this. Of course, we need to create a community of people that is using it, that's building it further and so on. And I think it's not very effective. We tell them they should do this, you know. They would have to do it because it's fun using it, right? So, but the planetary nervous system is a serious system in the sense that we can use it for many good purposes. So, first of all, we can do real-time measurements of the state of the world. Second of all, with this we can create greater awareness of the chances and risks to support everyone's decision making. Third of all, we can use the data to create knowledge, to learn about our world, to advance global society. And we can create self-organizing systems and also support collective intelligence. I'll be much more detailed in my second talk about all this, because there are already some things to demonstrate. Okay, so measuring the world in real time. Suppose there would be many people using this app, which is actually more an open platform than an app. And then basically, you know, we would do measurements, and putting all these measurements together would create knowledge about the world that would be available to everyone. because we're not a company, you know, this is going to create data for everyone. All our system, that's the idea. Second of all, with all this information, we can create more awareness to support better decisions, more convictions, and more responsible behavior. I'll give a few examples also in my second talk about this. The most interesting thing, however, is what the implications for complexity science are. We can learn so much now with all the data that we can generate about problems of the world. And epidemics is just one example. We'll mention many more examples of problems we haven't solved in the past, but I think we can solve in the future. How would we solve them? Well, here self-organization comes in. Once we have measured what's going on around us, in particular the externalities and the positive and negative external effects of our decisions and actions, we can create feedback effects. Of course, for this we need a particular system. We need to have a multidimensional incentive and reward system, and we're also planning to implement this. And here's just one example of an application. So today we have these annoying traffic jams every day. And at the moment, I'm just simulating the phenomenon to show you that our models are good enough to understand the problem and to reproduce it. We'll soon leave this car and to basically turn this into a helicopter in order to see what's going on. And what we're seeing here is that it's actually a few cars coming through this on-ramp, trying to get on the freeway, that produce small disruptions in the flow, and these disruptions are amplified and produce the stop and go traffic. Now, 10 years ago, we have already worked on a driver assistance system that would use radar sensor data to let cars drive automatically, but in a slightly different way. In a way that's not only increasing comfort, but also stabilizing traffic flow and increasing capacity. So what you see over here is that we can get rid of this traffic jam by changing the interactions between the cars, using real-time data and producing different kinds of real-time feedbacks. And that's kind of this general success principle for a distributed control that's going to produce favorable outcomes for our goal. And then, of course, what I really think is important in a world that's so complex that no single brain can understand it anymore, and also no artificial intelligence, I believe, it's important to bring the best ideas and many minds together. Collective intelligence is needed, and we need to build platforms that support the formation of collective intelligence. So, I'm coming to the end of this talk, and so what I have presented over here is basically the first step of an information infrastructure that will help us to bring everything together, science, politics, business, and society. Through this self-organization, I believe you will see massively increased efficiency. We'll see self-organizing, self-improving systems. All of this, now the second part of my talk, is based on the democratic principle of participation. At the heart is individual autonomy of decision-making. There's free entrepreneurial activity and markets. But we also consider externalities, and for this reason, it has other recurring effects, it's increasing fairness, and it's also taking care of environmental issues. Further on, it's supporting cooperation and reducing conflict. And in my other talk, I'm going to go into much more detail about all this. So, in other words, I believe the solution is not to create one giant clockwork that's going to control the world. We shouldn't turn our world into a giant clockwork, I believe. The solution is a nurtured and well-coordinated system of largely autonomous systems. And so, if you think this is the right way to go, then get ready. Team up with your friends and colleagues and join the NeuroStat team today. Thank you.